people in my union and the people in the trade union movement and in the labour movement stood back and did not participate in that election, and they did so, as has often been acknowledged, by the leaders of the Republican movement in the national interest. And many, many, many times since then, delegates, we have acted in the national interest. And these days we are being criticised for our failure to act in the national interest. And that arises from the fact that they are having difficulty with our response to their demand that we accede to pay cuts and the reduction of jobs, not only in the public service. Don't be fooled by that. This is about establishing it in the public service so that it can be driven right across the entire economy. Even though working people had no role whatsoever in the events which brought about the calamity that we are suffering now, which was entirely... due to the subservient and slavish acceptance of the neoliberal model of capitalism by the authorities here over the last 10 or more years, which is now collapsing across the globe with enormous consequences for all of humanity. What was sold to us 30 years ago by Thatcher and Reagan has turned out to be not something new. It's turned out to be a cruel deception. It was only old-fashioned 19th century liberalism, all dressed up, as Connolly would say, in the way of old wine in new bottles. And it is collapsing now, and working people across the world are expected to pay the price of it. That's the reality of it, and we should never forget it. I want to beg your indulgence to say this by way of clarification, and it won't make me popular to say it here, but we in the trade union movement have always acted in the national interest in this country, and we are prepared to act in the national interest again. We are not ignorant of the reality of the scale of the problems facing working people and our country, even though we had no part in creating it. But our problem is this. Our problem is that all too often in the history of our country, the national interest has been confused with the interests of the better off. That's the reality. And the reason for their irritation with us at the present time is not because we're ignorant. It's not because we are not prepared to play our part. It's not because we are not prepared to provide leadership, and it will be extremely difficult indeed. It's because we have insisted and will continue to insist that the burden for the resolution of these problems will not be placed exclusively on the shoulders of working men and women and their families. We have insisted that there is only one way to address the challenge facing us all, and that's by a major national initiative to which all sectors of society must contribute, and they must contribute in accordance with their means, and that means that those who have the most must contribute the most. That's the reality. Debating how working people can carry the burden for this crisis. Should it be pay cuts? Should it be job cuts? Should it be cuts in welfare? Should it be cuts in public services? We've had a lot of that over the last 6, 8, 10 months, but we haven't heard a word. Have you? Have you heard a word about what the other side are going to contribute? Have we had any discussion in our public media about how those who have done best during the Celtic Tiger years would play their part in the resolution of this crisis? Not a word. And we want the answer to that question before we say much more about what working people should contribute. that they have taken us to the place that in this republic, after 15 years of unprecedented growth, we find ourselves in the place that billions must be found, feather or fish, to shore up our banking system. And we can't find 9 million euro to inoculate our young women against one of the most pernicious. This is your event, and it's been a great privilege to be allowed 5 minutes and to take 10 to put out the event. On behalf of everyone in SIPTU, including those who don't know we're here, I want to thank most profoundly, the OConnor of Sinn Féin and the President of Sinn Féin and you, Chéad, for presenting me as the person who very humbly stands in the legacy of Larkin and Connolly for a while, the opportunity to set the record straight, the opportunity to be afforded a right of audience in a place we didn't have right of audience 90 years ago this day, by reason of the fact that we stood back to ensure that those articulating the demand for an independent republic would have a free run. I want to thank you most profoundly for affording me the opportunity of setting the record straight here. And whereas our paths have certainly diverged, the paths of the Republican movement and the trade union and labour movement widely over the intervening years. And whereas criticism has been directed both ways, and sometimes in both cases justifiably, I think over these past 5 years we have been together on several platforms in the battle to combat against the exploitation of working men and women, regardless as to their country of origin, who went to work in Ireland. And we have been together as well on platforms of these last few days in solidarity with the beleaguered women and children and the men and the innocent people of Palestine who are suffering. On earth. And I hope that this event here tonight augurs well for our continuing cooperation and our continuing presence on several platforms as we pursue in a principled way the aspirations of those who supported not just the paper but the spirit of the democratic programme which was adopted here 90 years ago this day. I thank you all.